things I've celebrated, sweet drink I've tasted, they come and go. But there was a treasure poured without measure over the earth. A light that so bright it outshines the brightest lights of the world. No greater friend I know, no greater peace I know, no greater hope I know, no greater joy I know. I can search high and low, even everywhere I go. No greater river flows than you, Jesus. Yeah. Yeah. No greater love. My great inspiration, heart's motivation, still comes from you.
To take a slight detour away from King's Oil. There are about two or three sessions still left for King's Oil, but I felt in preparing for the prayer meeting yesterday, this was on Friday, I think, or Thursday, cast my mind in meditation, and I almost heard the Lord literally say to me, exhort and motivate the house with hope. Everyone say hope. Now, you must not lose your hope. Hope is extremely important. So this word today is coming to all of us as a prophetic statement. It's not so much doctrinal as in a teaching. As you know, this word is largely didactic. We're teaching oriented. It's a teaching us. We love God's word. We love the principles of God's word. But God instructed me to exhort the house. So we're moving from teaching to exhortation. Exhortation in itself is theological. Every exhortive word is doctrinal in itself. You can never ever move away from the word of God, even in your bid to encourage someone, because the basis of everything you would do is based upon scripture. It is the nature of anything prophetic to exhort. The scriptures are very clear in 1 Corinthians 13 or 12, rather, where Paul said that he who prophesies must seek to edification, exhortation, and comfort. Everyone say edification? Say build up. Exhortation. Say stir up. And comfort. Say cheer up. All prophecy should edify, exhort, and comfort. It should always build you up, stir you up, and cheer you up. Okay? Everyone say edification, exhortation, and comfort. That's what Paul said. If anybody is operating prophetically, when you prophesied over the one that you are speaking to, how the person should feel is edified, exhorted, and comforted, built up, stirred up, and cheered up. Amen. And that is what we hope to do this morning. Amen. God is instructing me to do this, and it was manifested in the focus of the prayer meeting yesterday. And specifically, the message is entitled Double for Your Trouble, right? Or A Sudden Good Break. Now, I'm not saying this because it's something nice to teach. If I had my way, I would continue with King's Oil. For me, that's also prophetic in that when we teach doctrines of that nature, we're giving you principles that you can install into your life, which in themselves are prophetic, that will lead to certain outcomes of blessing in your life. But God impressed upon my heart to tell you prophetically, in a bid to exhort you, edify you, and comfort you, that God is going to give you double for your trouble. That many of you are on the verge of a sudden good break that you need. Okay? Now, I'm not just saying this because they are nice phrases and good sermon content material. But this is the word of the Lord for today and for this house. Many of you have been tried. Many of you have been tested deeply and significantly. God has processed you before He will provide for you. The processing was necessary so you can handle the level of provision. If God gave you stuff prematurely, sometimes the blessing of the Lord can kill you if you're not ready to handle it. God will only give you what you can steward. God will never give you what you cannot manage. And if you haven't developed skill sets, either in ability or in character, if God brings you into arena of some breakthrough without having prepared you, what He provides for you will pulverize you, right? God is very faithful. I love the Caleb, I call him, my grandson. But if I tell him now, my little boy, here's the keys to my car. Go for it, young man, and have a ball. This is your grandfather's blessing. I want to bless you. My heart is good, but in my heart, I know he hasn't developed specific skill set, nor temperament of mind, nor character to handle that level of blessing yet. God is similarly inclined with His children. He sometimes waits for us. He wants to give us a lot, but He knows if what He gives us can kill us if we are not prepared to handle it. So what God does faithfully, He is faithful to process you before He provides for you. Okay? And I feel that many of you in this house and many listening via live stream have been processed sufficiently enough to enter your next era of management of particular resource and breakthrough that God has in store for you. Remember the prodigal son? The prodigal son's consistent cry to his father. This is in Luke 15 and verse 12. I'm not going to follow my notes as they are, because my mind right now is all over the place. Let me just speak as the Holy Ghost gives utterance. In Luke 15 and verse 12, the younger of them said to his father, "Father, give me the share of the estate that falls to me." And so he divided his wealth between them. The young son, and the reference to young here is immature, not fit enough to handle an inheritance. So he wanted something prematurely before he was fit enough in terms of his character and his mindset to handle that level of blessing. This is the parable of the so-called prodigal son. Remember the young son, there were two, the old and the younger. The young son came to the father and said, he said this, the younger of them, the immature of them, said to his father, Father, give me the share of the estate that falls to me. You know the story. He wasted the inheritance on riotous living, right? Very quickly, he was degenerated and devolved to the level of a pig. Even his friends deserted him. And the only food he could find, the only work he could find, was some farmer hired him. And his job description was looking after pigs and feeding pigs. And he found the pig's husks, the ideal food, because there was no other food he could eat. So there's no lower place than a man can stoop than that. And he comes living the life of great wealth and being reduced to such a level. There are many people whose breakthrough becomes the start of their breakdown, simply because they were not sufficiently prepared to handle that level of prosperity. You must always be very, very careful when you come into breakthrough that you don't become insane and you don't lose your mind, right? You must always remain sober. I may speak on this in next week, God. Just this morning, I woke up and I penned in a whole lot of other thoughts, which I may not get to because of time here. But God told me this very, very thing. Tell your people not to be disoriented mentally by the things I do. To remain sober, to maintain your sobriety, to remain even keeled, to remain mentally balanced. And don't change your personality nor your character by the things that God will do for you. If anything, what God does should humble you. If any change that needs to be in you should be one of serious humility, godly fear, and reverence, lest you lose in a day what God took years to give you. Sometimes God took years to give a man a thing, and sometimes because of his mismanagement based upon greed, ambition, or carnality, or whichever. I'll prove this to you when we start the firstborn sonship series very, very soon. You can come into it having been processed through time, and you can lose things in a day if you are not careful. And so my encouragement to you is, like the prodigal son, don't become insistent on breakthrough or provision if you haven't developed the necessary and the requisite character disposition to handle significant levels of breakthrough. The desire of this young son was, Father, give me. And many Christians are like that. Gimme, 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 gimme. My name is Jimmy. Right? Just want. My whole Christian life is about me being materially well off or needs satisfied. If that doesn't happen, I'm depressed. Now that is a carnal approach, mindset to the Christian faith. Because then what happens when God submits you to a test? When he withholds provision, right? Talk to Job. The man was a multi-millionaire in his day. And from that level, he was reduced to an absolute pauper, right? An absolute pauper, lost all assets. I'm talking livestock. I'm talking physical structures, houses. He lost all family, all children killed. A wife turns on him and scorns him. Sickness boils, I'm talking about from head to toe. Now you suffer with one boil. How about boils all over from head to toe? The man suffered as any human being could suffer in all points, reduced to absolutely nothing. And his wife said, curse God and die. Why are you still loving this God of yours? And he says, shall we not receive bad at the hand of the Lord and good also? We must learn to manage both. His words were, the Lord has given, the Lord has taken away, and his response is, blessed be the name of the Lord. His relationship with God was not based on anything material. Whether I have or whether I don't have, Barak, blessed be the name of the Lord. You know what blessed in the Hebrew means? Barak means to declare God to be the origin of prosperity, productivity, and breakthrough. Repeat this after me. God is the origin of prosperity, productivity, and breakthrough. That's what the Hebrew word bless means, Barak, B-A-R-A-K. So when Job said, Barak be the name of the Lord, he's saying, no, my wife, we can't curse God, but I lift up my hand and God, I declare you to be the source of all blessing, all productivity, all breakthrough comes from you. And Job ended up with twice. You know the story? Everyone said double for your trouble. In Job 42, let's go there. In Job 42, can you find the text? I'm not sure where the text is found, but I'm all over, like I said, in my notes this morning. I'm just flowing with the leading of the Holy Spirit. In Job 42, the very, very last chapter in the book of Job, you'll find this statement where Job lands up with double for his trouble. Everyone say double for his trouble, right? Double for his trouble. The Lord gave back to Job twice whatever he has lost. Now, I want to encourage you. And if you look at Job 42, you must read the whole account today when you get back home. There are numbers there. There's a actual record of how much livestock and how many sons and how many daughters and everything that was restored back to this man. But Job proved a point that he had the sufficient character, metal internally, to handle great breakthroughs and great trials. Those things did not define who he was, nor defined his response of worship and love and adoration to God his Father. He lived beyond that. And I want to get to that place where my life is not defined by what God does for me. And let me just say this. I'm saying all of this as a prelude to where I'm going. Because if you only focus on what he can do for me, if your view is in this service, double for my trouble, and your eye is looking out for what is the next thing he's going to do. And let me just say this, he will do great things. Tell someone he's going to do mighty things. But God is more concerned about making you than giving you something. Okay? The prodigal son said, first, Lord, give me. Father, give me. But after he was reduced to a pigsty, remember he came running back to his father's house, right? His prayer changes in verse 19 of Luke 15. In verse 12, it's Lord, give me, give me. In verse 19, I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me, make me, make me, not give me, give me, give me. Everyone say, make me. God is more concerned about making you than giving you. Okay? And I really want to encourage us all this year more than ever before. God is going to process you. He has processed you, but he's going to process you more and more because he's more interested in your maturity than in your material prosperity. And let me just say this. Get ready for material prosperity, but don't let that sidetrack you. Don't let it derail you. Don't let it detour you. Your breakthrough can become the start of your breakdown. In Deuteronomy 8:18, God had to warn Israel, when you come into the land and you occupy farms that you never established, you start to harvest crops that you never planted, fields that were not yours, and you come into this level of breakthrough. When you enter the land, you shall not forget that it is the Lord your God that giveth thee the power to get wealth. God had to warn them because God knows the power. God knows the temptation and the power of breakthrough. It can mess people up. And God had to warn them, when that happens, you will not forget. You shall remember the Lord your God, for it is he who has given you the power to make wealth, that he might confirm his covenant, which he swore to your fathers, as it is this day. Was Abraham wealthy or not? Come on, talk to me. Was Abraham wealthy? Yes, he was a multimillionaire. Was Isaac wealthy? Yes, was Jacob wealthy? All the patriarchs were extremely well off, well stacked, lacking nothing. But with each of them, God had to take his time to prepare them to manage levels of breakthrough. If you study all of their lives, they had a significant level of trouble, all of them. But God gave them double for their God gave them double for their trouble. All had significant measures of major breakthroughs in their lives. But God had to put them through the process of His making before giving them something. God will make you before He gives you. If you have any desires and ambitions for greatness, which we all do, not so? We want to live a good life. We want our quality and standard of life to rise. Not so. We all want that. It's human and it's not unbiblical. God, the Bible says He will give you the desires of your He will give you the desires of your hearts. God is not a nasty, vindictive God that wants to withhold blessing and just give you a hard time on the earth. No, at some level or the other, sometime or the other, God will bring ease to your dis-ease. God will bring you relief where you need it. It's the nature of His being. It's the nature of His person. The promise to Abraham starts like this. Genesis 12 verse 2. Promise to Abraham, Genesis 12 and verse 2. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you. I'm not going to bless you until I make you. I'll make you first, then I bless you. God is more interested in making him. And yes, he'll make him a great nation. But God says, before I bless you, I need to make sure that you are made. Everyone say you are made. The Hebrew word for made here is nathan. And it literally means to set forth or to constitute specifically for an important function. Listen to the word nathan. When God says, I will make you, God is saying to Abraham, I nathan you. I will make you, constitute you, and place you specifically for a very important function in the earth. Right? You will have many children. Your children will be more than the stars in the sky, more than the sands of the sea. They're all sitting right here now. Any son of God is a son of Abraham through Jesus Christ, according to Galatians 3. You read the text there, you'll understand what I'm saying. Right? So God had in mind, this man will become a father of a multitude. Now, those of you who are fathers, you know, it takes a lot just to manage the two or three you have, not so? How about managing a multitude? How is Abraham going to have the mindset of stewarding multitudes through Christ? God had to process the man and set him forth for specific function. Before God gives the man blessing, God has to make the man in terms of strength, stature, temperament, obedience, test him to the hilt, even in giving up the son of his love. His firstborn is Isaac. Take your son, your only son whom you love, and sacrifice the boy. But God, this seems so incongruent. You just told me I'll be a father. Now the only indication of fathering I have, my son, you want me to give that up? Right? If Abraham did not obey that test, he would not be fathering all these sons today. If you are going to become the father of nations and a multitude, and you cannot give up your first, everyone say your first. Isaac is Abraham's first fruit. If you cannot give up the first, don't expect to harvest the plenty. Okay, it's a test of the heart. God will test you financially, even in terms of your obedience. God will test you relationally. How quick is your forgiveness of people who hurt you? Right? Every expectation of God's claim on your life to obey Him is a test. It's God's way of checking you out. And let me just say this. God has time, but you don't. Just bump someone till you're getting old if you don't know it. Time is, you know, when I look at my grandsons, I realize, Barnwell, you are not getting younger. Right? Actually, 60 is round the corner. Right? I'll be 60 in 5 years. Think about it. Can you believe it, brethren? Right? It's like impossible to even to factor in the mind that we are talking these numbers. And I'm saying to God, my desire is to at least live to 130. Oh, he of little faith. You know, the benchmark is between 80 and 90 these days, so close thereabouts. Trusting God for a long, full life. I want to be like Job, the Bible says, and he died having seen four generations. full of days. I want to die full of days. I want to die like Moses, the Bible says, and he went up to a mount. God actually told him, go up to the mount and die there. Well, how do you like that? God tells you where you're going to die and what time. God told him, go up to the mount and die there. And he went up, he saw the land, and he went to be with his fathers, the scripture says. But the Bible says, and he came to the grave in full vigor. His eyes not being dimmed. No glasses in those days. But he had no eyesight problems. He was full stature, full strength, full vigor. Amen. Bump your neighbor and say, trust God that you'll die full of days. Say you'll die full of strength. Yeah? I'm going to die weak. If I'm going to die, I'll die strong. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Trust God for these things. So God is more interested in, before he blesses Abraham, he is going to make Abraham. Now, let me get to the kernel of where I want to go. I'm saying all of that as a prelude to what I want to say now, because it's very necessary that you master that dimension of understanding your desire and your prayer before God is, make me the vessel that you want me to be. Before you bless me, make me. Deal with kinks in my character. Deals with flaws in my personality. Deal with the weakness of my flesh. Help me to overcome things so that when you do bring me into your level of breakthrough, nothing is compromised in my life that will cause it to leak out of my life. I'll be strong, I'll be focused, I'll be robust. When you are processed in this fashion, usually God will use a trial to test you, or an instruction to test your obedience. He will submit you to suffering, for example, because there are certain things that sufferings will teach you that a Bible study will not. The life's experiences are meant to educate you. The Bible says that Jesus learned obedience by the things he suffered. Hebrews 6, I'm quoting, or Hebrews 5. He learned obedience by the things he suffered. Obedience can be learned if it's not a reflexive, natural response. Whatever is not naturally reflexive, you can be tutored in, or you can learn the response. The word for suffered in that verse should not be translated in English as suffered. I don't know why the translators of the scriptures did that, because it's not the word suffered in the Greek. He learned obedience by the things he experienced. The word experience is the correct translation. All of life's experience are designed to bring you to a place of obedience. Everyone say obedience. God is more concerned that you master for obedience than he is about just giving you something. Do you know God can give you everything you need in the next hour? You just click the finger, whatever's on your heart, it'll be here in a moment. But he knows that I cannot give to you until I make you, until you're fully prepared to handle what I have in store for you. So bump your neighbor and say, cooperate with God's making process. While you suffer, here's my encouragement. Here is the exhortation. Here's the building up, the stirring up, the cheering up. While you suffer, do not lose hope. Because it's the easiest thing to, having not seen the reality of what you trust in God for, to give up hope and not to endure. I want to encourage you all to revisit the series on, I think it's the second, third, and fourth sessions on the faith series that we did in December 2019. The faith series was about, I think, 12 or so sessions. Very early on in that series, remember the series on endurance and hope? Faith is the substance, hope for, Hebrews 11, 1. Faith is the substance, hope for, the evidence of things not seen. King James, or New King James, the word assurance is correct, as I explained in that series. I don't want to go there now because it will take us on another detour. Faith is the substance, hope for. I told you, the word of things should not be in this verse. In all of your Bibles, the word of things is in italics. Any words in the Holy Scriptures that are in italics means it wasn't in the original text. It's an insertion by the translators. And so as to not break interpreting rules, translators always put words in italics that were not in the original text. It is their suggestion to make sense of the sentence. But this verse has messed up a lot of people because you think that faith's focus is things. When things were not in the verse, faith's focus is substance. Faith is the substance hoped for. That's how the verse should read. Faith is the substance hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. And I demonstrated to you in that session, the word substance is the Greek hypostasis. It means three things, but because of the sake of time, I'll just focus on one. Hypostasis has reference to the essential nature of God, right? It's a reference to His grace. Everyone say hypostasis. It literally means the reality that underlies an appearance. There's an appearance, but there's a reality that is submerged, that is holding up everything that appears externally. That undergirding reality we define as the grace of God. And what appears is the glory of God. Grace is the foundation to glory. Glory is the manifestation of the exact representation of His being. According to Hebrews 1:3. Everyone say the character of God. For ease of remembering. When you say hypostasis, it's the character of God. It's the essence of God. It's the person of God. Even in Hebrews 6, the foundation doctrine, it says faith toward God. Everyone say faith is toward God. You don't have faith in things, you have faith in God. And you have faith in God, not just for material things, you have faith in God for the person of God. Gary, that slide on those faith's focus, I think you do have it there. Remember we did this, the series? Whenever you think of faith's focus, three P's, person, principles, promise, and purposes. Remember, faith is first focused on God's person, right? Then it's focused on God's principles. You obey God's word, God's principles by faith. And then thirdly, it's focused on promises from God. You can have faith to believe that what God promised will come to pass. And then to fulfill something for God. By faith, Noah built an ark. Right? He's doing something by faith to fast track global purposes of God in the earth. It's got nothing to do with his personal materiality. By faith, Abel offered to God a more excellent sacrifice than his brother Cain. Abel used faith to give something away, not to get something to him. We only think of faith, gimme, 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 my name is Jimmy. Faith is this way for us. The Old Testament heroes of faith use this economy of faith for four things. And we must revisit this series at some stage. In fact, wouldn't it be a great idea to take Hebrews 11 apart? Long chapter. But take each personality. And a lot of the verses start, by faith, so-and-so did something. By faith. And see what was faith for that person in their day. If they look back at the modern church and say, my God, you people mess faith up. What on earth happened to pure, authentic faith? Firstly, faith's pursuit is God. Everyone say it's the hypostasis of God. You must never forget this. Faith is always focused on God's person. It's of God. It's focused on God's principles, things in God that you need to access through His word. It's focused on God's promises from God and focused on God's purposes for God. And it comes by the hearing of a rhema word. Faith comes. Everyone say faith comes. Faith comes, but faith goes too. It comes by the hearing of a rhema word. But if you hear the wrong word, it can go. Right? Now, the word that is rhema for us today. I want to encourage you not to lose your hope. Because Hebrews says, faith is the substance hope for. And hope elpizo in the Greek literally means a mental attitude of expectancy regarding something in the future. And then subsequently, it also means to act with desire. Repeat this after me: a mental attitude of expectancy concerning something in the future. Now, when you hope, you have a great expectation that something positive will happen in my future. Faith, I don't have time to give you the scriptures because of time. Faith is in the heart, hope is in the mind. Right? You get the breastplate of faith, and Thessalonians calls it the breastplate of righteousness also. The breastplate is both faith and righteousness. In the armor, you have the shield of faith. In the armor of God, although it says in Ephesians it's a breastplate of righteousness, Thessalonians also describes the breastplate as a breastplate of faith. The shield or the breastplate protects which vital organs of the body? Think of a Roman soldier. If he's got a breastplate on and a shield, what is he basically protecting? His heart. Vital organs here. But the scripture defines, it says, and for hope, the helmet of salvation. So hope is always, the helmet protects the mind, not so? So faith protects the heart, but hope protects the soul, the mind, the thinking. So when I say faith is, if you have faith, you also have hope. Right? So faith protects your heart against the fiery darts of the wicked one. What Ephesians 6 says, Satan fires these fiery darts, but what quenches the fiery darts? Everyone say, my shield of faith. Fiery means trials, the doctrine of the baptism of fire, sufferings. When Satan fires difficult times at you, it's your faith that will keep you strong. But you've got to have the shield and the helmet. Everyone say, put your helmet on. The helmet of salvation biblically is defined as hope. So, you know, a lot of times when the fiery darts come, fire, symbol of suffering, from the enemy, you tend to lose hope and you tend to relax your endurance. You don't endure until you end. And the Bible says in Hebrews, we must imitate those of old who through faith and patience and endurance obtained the promises. Okay? And I believe we are on the verge of obtaining promises in many respects in the current season. Because God is going to reward you for your diligence. But don't give up. Don't relax. You can have faith in the heart, but put the helmet on also. Think positively. Hope is a positive mental attitude of expectation regarding the future. Don't be pessimistic. Don't say the wrong things all the time. Don't speak negatively to your spouse and say things won't work out, or it's all downhill here from now. Faith is always manifested by accurate speech. You know that? Faith in the heart, confession through the mouth. Okay? It's always manifested. This is not New Age positive speaking. This is biblical speaking based upon a fact of truth in God's word. So God said to Abraham, go up to the mount, take your only son and kill the boy there. At the base of the mount, before he goes up, the Bible says, Abraham left his men at the bottom of the hill. And as he went up, he said to the men, you wait here. The lad and I, we will come back to you again. But God told me to kill the boy on the mount. But my confession, I believe so much that even if I kill him, Romans says, Abraham believed that God would have been obliged to raise him from the dead. Abraham's talk did not discount what he believed in his heart. Amen. Don't let this be this discongruence or incongruence between what you believe and what you say. Now, the message starts now. I'll be brief. That's all like a prelude so we can have the mindset to understand what God is wanting to do now. Zechariah 9 and verse 11 and 12. This is a word which I believe will encourage you. We focused on this at prayer meeting yesterday, and there was such a grace and such an anointing. Zechariah 9 and verse 11. As for you also, because of the blood of my covenant with you. This, we celebrated communion this morning. Jesus said, this is the new covenant in my blood. Through the covenantal blood arrangement, we are sons of God in the family of God. We're part of the kingdom of God. God has taken us out of the kingdom of darkness and into the kingdom of his dear son. We are in the family of God. This verse says, as for you, because of that, the blood of my covenant with you, I have set your prisoners free from the waterless pit. Water is a consistent imagery of the word of God. A pit is a deep, dark dungeon, right? A hole in the ground with no water, according to the scripture. If water is a picture of God's word, a waterless pit, therefore, is a deep, dark place with no manifestation of God's word. Now, many of you might feel that you are there. You might feel that my life's experiences have been a deep, dark dungeon where I am in Gate Ministries, Durban Central. I am part of a church where there's rich word. I hear the word all the time. But in my life, it's a dungeon. In my life, it's a pit. In my life, it's waterless, not waterfall. Even though I'm hearing good word all the time, the word has not become incarnated, not manifest in my experience. I am not seeing, for example, if you say this to yourself, I am not seeing what my pastor teaches proclaimed from the pulpit. I am not seeing evidence in my life. I see lofty, powerful, God-ordained principles, but my life is waterless. In fact, it's become a prison, according to the text. The thing has shackled me. It has limited me. The thing has encased me. And I want to tell you today, the text says, I have set your prisoners free from the waterless pit. Today is a day of liberation. I say this as a prophetic word over this house in the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ over all of you today. By today, your presence in this meeting and those listening via online, the Lord breaks the inability to incarnate what you hear in your life. No more will it be waterless in your life, and no more will it be a deep, dark dungeon. No more will you be imprisoned by the failure to incarnate the truth of what you hear. I impose and I impart to you by my utterance today, if you would receive it, the ability to take what you hear on a Sunday or whenever we preach and to go out of those doors and design an architecture, a template of life where the word becomes manifest in your life by your character, by your decisions, by your behavior. It's one thing to hear a good word. Everyone say design. I use these words poignantly. You hear something, your heart should be, I'm going to go out and I'm going to design my life according to what I've heard. I won't think about it too much. I will simply obey reflexively. Don't negotiate too much with what you hear. If I were you, I'll take what you hear and I will obey it reflexively. Bump your neighbor and say, just do it. I say, just obey. So I declare your days of a waterless pit are over. No more will there be the absence of the incarnate word manifest in your experience. So now if we say something from the pulpit, we want to see something in your lives. Then the text goes on. Return to the stronghold. Quentin read a text today that David was in the stronghold at Adullam, right? And he desired water from the wells of Bethlehem. The stronghold, biblically, is a place of safety. The word literally means the safe place. Return to the safe place. Come back. I say to you prophetically, come back to a place of safety. Come back to the place of the stronghold. Oh, prisoners. But you are not just prisoners of a waterless pit. You've never lost your hope in the pit. It says prisoners of hope. Hope proves that you still have faith, because faith is the substance hope for. And I'm saying to you, you might have lost everything. It might be a deep, dark dungeon prison in your life, but at least there's a little bit of faith present and a residual, if it must be, maybe an iota left, but you still have the faith. And if you have the faith, it means you've never lost your hope. Bump your neighbor and say, don't cast away your confidence. I'm using biblical language here. Don't cast away your hope. Don't say, wow, 2023 got off to a bad start. Sure, Lord, the year hasn't even started and the trials are following soon after. I'm saying to you, change. Don't be pessimistic about how the year would go. You see, if you think it, you will experience it. If it's in your mind, it's in your future. But if you, as a man, think so easy. All I'm asking is think hopefully. Change your confession. Think positively and you're going to see outcomes. The text says, prisoners of hope. So the prison status of the person has changed from being a prisoner of a waterless pit to a prisoner of hope. That's a good imprisonment, to be a prisoner of hope. Paul says, I am the prisoner of the Lord Jesus Christ. You must be imprisoned by the right thing, right? Tell your neighbor, I'm a prisoner of hope. Others bound by hope. Hope, which is the mental attitude of expectation concerning the future. I am holding on. Everyone say, hold on, right? This very day, I'm declaring I will restore double. Everyone say, double for your trouble. You see, some of you have been in that waterless dungeon for too long, and God says, I am going to give you double for your trouble. The NLT says it like this, same verse. Because of the covenant I made with you, sealed with blood, I will free your prisoners from death in a waterless dungeon. Come back to the place of safety. All you prisoners who still have hope, I promise this very day I will repay two blessings for each of your troubles. Two blessings for each of your troubles. Double for your troubles. Job 42:10. We just referenced him a few minutes ago. The Lord restored the fortunes of Job when he prayed for his friends. And the Lord increased all that he had twofold. God doubled the restoration of Job's fortunes because he prayed for his friends. Isaiah 61 and verse 7. Isaiah 61 and verse 7. Instead of your shame, you will have double portion. Instead of humiliation, they will shout for joy over their portion. Therefore, they will possess a double portion in the land, and everlasting joy will be theirs. Everlasting joy will be theirs. The word that God gave me said this: tell the people that I'm going to do double. I'm going to give them double for their trouble. Many of you, like I said, have been processed significantly. It's like you've been through the mill of God's testing process. And God said, I've proven you and found you faithful. Now I will reward you, declares the Lord. You are going to receive double. Now this is a dangerous word in the hands of the wrong people. Right? Because if you don't understand that God first makes me so I can manage what he gives me, I don't want anyone to leave this meeting becoming covetous. I don't want to encourage a covetous spirit here. Because the covetous spirit is not encouraged in the scripture. We just want things for their own sake. But God will give you because you will use whatever you have for his kingdom purpose and to fast track all that he is desirous to do within your life. What's going to happen is this. When God does these things, and many of you are going to testify and come back to me and say, wow, this happened to me. God's going to cause you to be humbled by the things he will do for you. You know why? You'll know that you're not deserving. You will know this is not me. This is the favor of God. And did not Sean Blucknow share with us this word, Psalm 102 and verse 13? For you will arise and have compassion on Zion. For the time to be gracious to her or to favor her, the appointed time has come. Surely your servants find pleasure in her stones and feel pity for the dust thereof. Now, there is favor. Everyone say favor. Favor is going to come upon us. But we must find pity in the stones and find pleasure in the stones of Zion, in other believers. When was the fortunes of Job changed? When did Job come into double? Come on, answer me. When? When he prayed for his friends. God was waiting. Job, I made you suffer. I'm just waiting for to check. Did you master forgiveness to those three friends who throughout the whole of your book misjudged you, attacked you? You see, I can give you something in a day, but I'm more concerned about your heart. Have you cooperated with the making process? Are you still full of bitterness, Job? Is there resentment? Is there anger in your heart against the three friends? God was just waiting for one final step of Job's making process before God says, double. Everyone do this, double. It's like God was waiting, holding double for Job and say, Job, yes, double. But I'm waiting to check, have you passed the forgiveness test? Have you passed the resentment test? Are you full of malice, anger? Will you ever invite those friends back to dinner again? Right? Let me check your heart out, Job. When God says, wow, the man cooperated with my making process, now my material blessing, he has just proven he has the metal to manage double. Right? You see, many of us that were not Job and still have anger, if God gave us double, we'll say, now friends come and see the blessing of the Lord. You know, I hate those sometimes posts on Facebook which says, may the Lord bless you with long life enough and bless you with huge this and that so that it can your enemies can see how God is. No, that's totally unbiblical. Don't like those things, brethren. And share the wrong things. Totally unbiblical. Right? And you know what the Bible says? All Job's family, his brothers and sisters, after that, read the text. They came to visit him with gifts of gold and silver. Right? The man proved I passed the relational test. God made me. Now God can give me. But God will never give you until he has made you. Just one or two scriptures quickly. Luke chapter 5 quickly. Luke chapter 5. It happened that while the crowd was pressing around him, listening to the word of God, he was standing by the lake Gennesaret. He saw two boats at the edge of the lake, but the fishermen had gotten out of them and were washing their nets. This is the account of the calling of the first set of disciples. Right? Jesus is going to call some disciples to follow him. Peter will be one of them. Watch this. He got into one of the boats, which was Simon. Simon is Peter. Simon is his other name. And he asked them to put out a little distance from the land, and he sat down and he continued teaching the crowds from the boat. Jesus needs a pulpit here, right? He needs something, a structure, so he can preach effectively. Too many crowds by the edge of a lake. His plan is, let me get somebody's boat here, push it a little way so I can stand there and talk to everybody. Everybody. So there were two boats, so he asked for the use of one. They put it out and he starts to preach, right? So it was Simon's, Peter's boat, right? So when he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, put into the deep water and let down your nets for a catch. You see, the boat that you offer for Jesus as a pulpit to preach God's word will be the boat that will get the blessing of great fish, right? I want to bless you, Peter, with a great catch of fish this day. But until I check your heart out, are you willing to offer your boat for preaching, for the publicization of the kingdom message? If you're willing to offer your life, your energy, all your resources for my purposes, then I can bless you. There's no business. By the way, this was a business. These were businessmen. Fishing was their business. It was their occupation. There's no business that prioritizes God's agenda where that business will not be blessed. Amen. Now, I want to encourage all the business people, put God first, even financially, and see how your boat will be blessed. Amen. And then it says this. Let's quickly get through this. He said to Simon, put out your net into the deep water. Everyone say, go into the deep. Launch out into the deep. And catch nothing by the edge of the lake here. So go into the deep, Peter. Don't be afraid. Simon responded, Master, we've been working hard all night and caught nothing. But we will do as you say. And he let down the nets. And when he had done this, they caught a great quantity of fish. And their nets began to break or to tear. So they signaled to their partners in the other boats to come and help them. And they came and they filled the boats to the point where they were sinking. But Simon, when Simon saw this is what I want to get at. Everyone say, great breakthrough. Check Peter's response to great breakthrough. Check Peter's response to the great doings of the Lord in his business. The business flourished that day, not so. Peter, as a businessman, extremely happy, right? When Simon Peter saw that, he fell down at Jesus' feet. Go away from me, my Lord. I am a sinful man. The breakthrough of Christ, the double for your trouble. You took your boat trouble and you gave it to me. What you should be using for fishing, you use it for kingdom purpose. You paid a price, Peter. Now I bless you. Now the blessing of the Lord did not fill Peter with pride. The blessing of the Lord filled Peter with great humility. And he comes to Christ and he bows down and he said, I am a sinful man. Verse 9, go away, for amazement had seized him and all his companions because of the catch of fish which they had taken. Likewise were also with him James and John, the sons of Zebedee. You know that Peter, James, and John will become the inner circle of the crew of disciples. He's the ones closest to him. Right? This Jesus said to Simon, do not fear. From now on, you will be catching people or fish. You'll be fishing for men. Right? And what I really want to encourage you, the Bible says they brought their boats to the land and they left everything and they followed him. Always look to the hidden principle when God breaks through for you. Don't be mesmerized by the fish and forget that possibly in this, there's a higher calling. Look to the greater revelation behind what he does. So in the feeding of the 5,000, remember the fish and the bread multiplied. Not so? Multiplied. And in the same chapter or the next one, Jesus would say, I am the bread that has come down from heaven. I did something natural to reveal something spiritual. In John 11, when he raised Lazarus from the dead, what did he say? I am the resurrection and the life. In John 10, when they did not know shepherding, I am the good shepherd. In John 14, I am the way, the truth, and the life. If you never ever allow what God does for you to reveal God to you, you're going to miss the boat, literally. Right? Whenever God does some breakthrough for you, always ask yourself, what is the hidden text here, God? I'm not just going to be so enthralled by, sure, you broke through. And yes, we all become happy, not so. Yes, we are happy for what he's done. But our hearts are, what are you trying to even teach me about yourself in what you've done for me? Always let the works of God lead you to the person of God. Right? Always let what God does for you, not to fill you with pride, to humble you and say, God, depart from me. I'm humble. I'm not worthy. Later on, when he rose from the dead in John 21, remember Peter went back to fishing? Peter said, I'm going fishing. Remember? I taught you this some months ago. I'm going fishing. And then when Jesus appeared on the shore and he called out to them, they didn't know who it was. John was the one who recognized his voice. This is the Lord. When Peter heard it's the Lord, the Bible says, and he put back his garment on because he had taken it off to fish. He put his garment back on and he had taken it off to fish. In other words, watch carefully as we close. He walked with Christ for 3 years from the point of the first fishing miracle. Remember the first fishing miracle? I use your boat. I bless you. I give you double for your trouble. It has humbled you, Peter. You're doing well. Now you followed me for 3 years. I die. I'm dead. Right? You think that 3 years of your life has been wasted because you've given yourself to this master, this Lord, the Savior, and you've actually left fishing. Now that I'm dead, you think all is lost and you go back to fishing. And the Bible says the others went with him. He was highly influential, Peter. So they leave the apostolic call to take up something out from which he called them. Right? And when Jesus says, now throw your nets onto the other side, a second fishing miracle, they caught 153 large fish, the text says. When Peter realizes, the Bible says he took his fishing garment off and he put back his apostolic call. And he came to Jesus. In other words, the breakthrough of 153 for Peter in that instance led him to get back to the original call where God originally called him into. You see, Peter wasn't saying, wow, 153 fish. Woo, breakthrough, double for my trouble. Woo, God is doing. And forget, hey, I need to take this fishing garment off. This is not the main thing. Let me put on the apostolic call and now start to cash. Men, I say this to you and submit this to you. God's going to do something practical in your life. But if you fail to see the higher symbolic principle, you're going to miss a major thing in God. And you'll be totally so focused on the thing he did without learning the greater thing. Always open your eyes. This year, God's going to give you double for your trouble. I, as your father in Christ, I'm giving you counsel. When this does happen, throw the party. Celebrate for one night. Be human. Tell your neighbor, party. Come on. We get happy, not so? I'll be very happy. If anyone knows me, I can rejoice, brethren. I'm glad for what? Then I'll have a sober moment and say, now God, what were you trying to show me? What were you trying to teach me? What about your person? You've humbled me. Let the major breakthrough humble you first, not full with pride. Then ask God, what are you trying to teach me? You fed 5,000, multiplying bread and fish simply to teach. I am the bread of life. Let what you do for me lead to a revelation of your person. My faith is not in things. My faith is on the hypostasis. It's your person. It's you that I want to know. Don't just want the breakthrough for its own sake. I want to know you. Everyone say, I want to know you. This year is going to be a year of great breakthrough. But don't become covetous. Become obsessed with knowing him. You know, I love how Peter was dealt with here. When they caught 153 fish, this is John 21. And he comes. The Bible says Jesus had already started the charcoal. There was a braai going on there. Right? And the fish was already on the braai. And the Bible says he sat down and he broke the bread and he gave them the fish. And they ate to their heart's content. Then afterwards, the Bible says, he called Peter aside. Peter, do you love me more than these? I always bothered about that scripture. What did Jesus mean when he said to Peter, do you love me more than these? What are the these in that text? It's not the other disciples. I believe it's these fish. It's this breakthrough. Do you love me or my breakthrough? Because if you're so obsessed with what I've just done, you've missed the boat. And then he would ask him 3 times, if then you do love me, feed my sheep. tend my lambs. Three times, feed my sheep, Peter. I perceive for many of you, please, this is very important to me, this sermon, extremely important. Because when God does the big thing, I'm going to be the first one watching you. Everyone say eyes on deck now. Because now you've been taught, right? So I don't want to see now you come into great prosperity and the thing derails you. A lot of people come into prosperity and we don't see them. Literally don't see them. They disappear. Right? Or they come into and their character changes. David said this, in my prosperity, I will not be moved. Right? In my prosperity, I will not be moved. God's going to do amazing things. But I'm going to ask you the question. Do you love him more than these? Amen. Lift up your hands to the Lord. And let me just say this, that you lift your hands up. Like Peter went from taking off the fishing garment, putting on an apostolic garment, to come back to the original call. God's going to redirect your steps to come back to what you should be focusing on. But he's going to give you a sign this year. Amazing breakthrough. Double for your trouble. But please, brethren, be sober. Be measured. Be calculated in your responses to the things that God will do this year. Father, in Jesus' name, we just thank you for the hope that you've given to us, that we will not be prisoners of a waterless pit, but prisoners of hope, and that you would give us double for our trouble. And when you do these things, may it humble us, because we know we're not worthy, but you deem us fit. You've processed us, for many of us, you've made us, you've tested us, you've tried us. For some of us, it's been so exacting. For some of us, we would not have known that we could have endured another day, Lord. But we are standing here today, in 2023, having gone through stuff. Make us a vessel. Make us an offering. Make us whatever you want us to be. As to Abraham, you said, I will make you, then I will bless you. We ask for the making of the Lord. Prepare us in Jesus' name to be good stewards of all the good things that you have in store for us. When you do these things, may what you do unveil to our hearts a revelation of who you are. We love you more than these. Yes, we do. We love you more than breakthrough. We love you more than material possessions. We love you more than the things you're going to do. But we ask, do the things so that the things will enlarge in our love for you. I pray in Jesus' name that you'd give every family in this house double for their trouble. Give every family in this house a sudden break, good break, a breakthrough. I ask for the things we've been longing for. For some, Father, I ask this week, may we hear of testimonies of look at what the Lord has done. Look at what God has done. When you do these things, we will be humble and give you glory. We will not forget. It is the Lord our God that gives us the power to get wealth, that he might establish his covenant with us. I pray blessing upon every single person, from the youngest to the oldest. I pray even, God, people in business will come to new expressions of breakthrough, of the doing of the Lord. What you do will amaze us. What you do will enthrall us. In Jesus' name, we give you glory for the things you would do. We give you thanks, and we look forward with expectant hope, with great anticipation for the doing of the Lord in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. 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 Tell someone, receive the word of the Lord. Amen.